Thank you so much. It's a great pleasure to be here and to talk about Need, Speed, and Greed, my new book on the future of global innovation. I want to make the argument that the world faces unprecedented global challenges. Let's call them wicked global problems, and argue that, in fact, innovation can help us tame the most wicked of these problems, but we need to think again about how we innovate and embrace an approach to innovation that's much more radical, much more disruptive, and much more democratic than the approach taken thus far. And in making this argument, I want to offer you one definition, debunk six myths of innovation, and give you three rules. All this in 12 minutes. Are you ready? All right. In doing so, when I talk about need, I'm talking about, of course, the extraordinary global challenges that have come about as a result of the confluence of the rise of India, China, the other BRICS economies, the urbanization of mankind, we are urban species for the first time in human history, as well as the underbelly of globalization and Googleization, these wonderful forces that have made our lives so much better. But we now know that the world is not flat, it's lumpy and bumpy, and we're dealing with the underside of these problems now, whether it be pandemics or climate change, or some of these other difficulties that come from our hyper-connectedness. And so the first of the myths that I wanted to get to, really in dealing with need, the problems that the leaders of the world, especially in the West, have been dealing with the first 10 years of this new century as the most difficult problems, the financial crises that is right at our doorstep, as well as the war on terror post September 11th in the US. These may seem like the most important problems in the world, but in fact, seen from the vantage point of our children and our grandchildren, we will be judged by much more difficult problems. We will be judged by how we handled this once in 500 year transition that we're living through as the extraordinary wave of humanity rises. A billion people are lifted out of poverty in one generation. And the impact that has on resources, how we deal with that challenge is really what we'll be judged by. After all, remember, political terrorism has been with us for more than 1,000 years. And even financial crises have gone hand in hand with capitalism for as long as capitalism has been with us. But these other problems are unprecedented in scope and scale. And that is what I say cries out for need. That is a new way to do innovation. And that's where I also want to get to another one of the myths. That is, people that look at these problems and say, there's a population bomb. People are the problem. The only way out is resource wars. How many of us have heard that there's going to be a war over water, for example, going forward? I think I see a lot of hands. I think this is fundamentally the wrong way to think about the problem when we look at this question. People are a part of the solution. People aren't the problem. When we actually see where people are empowered, where they have access to the tools of innovation, education, empowerment, you actually find Bill Gates's and Steve Jobs's arriving in the most unexpected corners of Bangladesh or rural Kenya, frugal engineers popping up in India and China, contributing solutions, novel approaches to these resource problems. So I think people are a part of the solution, they're not the problem. And secondly, when we talk about resource wars, this is a kind of thinking that came out of the 70s with the Club of Rome group of thinkers that argued resources are running out. The world would have run out of oil, would have run out of other resources by now, food. But of course, we know that didn't happen. Straight line projections, when they continue forever, make me a bit suspicious. And of course, what those projections forgot and what the chorus of despair forgets is that when we look at development, it's not a straight line, it's a dynamic dance. Once we take account of price signals, markets, substitution, investment, innovation, what you really find is that the resource base is not fixed. It expands with innovation. And a small example of that, back in 1950, granite in the state of Vermont in America was a worthless material used for tombstones. By 1980, it became incredibly precious. Why? The civilian nuclear industry had taken off, and there was uranium in those rocks. My point is this, when the very definition of resources changes over time, you can't hold on to a static, linear perspective about how the world works. Innovation has to be the solution. What about speed? I want to put to you that, in fact, there are the very ways in which we innovate is being transformed. The very meta innovation or the rules of innovation are being innovated themselves. And that's very exciting. And it leads to three new rules if you want to survive and if you want to flourish in this new age of disruptive innovation. And some of you will be familiar with this, being cutting edge innovators. But you have to move nimbly, you have to be agile, and you have to fail gracefully. And each of these now is gaining hold, and I talk to companies, entrepreneurs, CEOs, people going about their lives. These rules, I think, are really going to transform how innovation is done. But embedded in them, though, also comes fallacies. That's what I wanted to poke at just a bit. Being nimble, you know, even an industry that calls itself the fast-moving consumer goods industry is now moving at twice the pace. Procter & Gamble, for example, its internal research shows that product life cycles are less than half what they used to be 15 years ago because barriers to entry are falling around the world, new competitors are coming, they're moving to market a lot faster than the traditional multinationals are used to. Recently spoke with the head of innovation at one of the big German car companies. He said, look, we used to move at the pace of our industry, maybe a little bit faster. Now we have to move at the pace of China. And I think that is what you're beginning to see in a lot of industries. You must be nimble. But this doesn't mean that there's no room or scope for the old storied multinationals. That's a myth. If you actually see, Siemens has been with us for 160 years. IBM just celebrated 100 years. What this means, though, is that the dinosaur has to learn how to dance. If you look about agility, you have to look at openness as well. The world has become a wiki world. We all know about how open networked approaches to innovation are taking off. The traditional corporate silo of R&D where men with gray beards and white coats used to look for Nobel Prizes, well, that model of R&D is producing diminishing returns. So you really need to have open eyes. Bill Joy famously said, the smartest people in your industry don't work for your company anymore. That was true 10 years ago, it's even more true now. So lots of people do open innovation. They put on incentive prizes, they do networked, user-generated innovation. But here too, there's a bit of a fallacy. Just crowdsourcing doesn't always lead to a wisdom of the crowds. Sometimes it leads to a bland mediocrity of the crowds as well. And sometimes the true genius of outliers can be masked by either power users with an agenda or just, again, a bland mediocrity. So I say you really need to know how to pick and choose when it comes to being open. And the best companies, to take IBM for an example, they make a great deal about being open, about their Linux system, open innovation. But if you look carefully, they're also incredibly secretive, and they patent more than just about any other company on Earth the last 5 years. And so parts of their business, they're quite secretive. Parts of their business, they're quite open. The real key is in figuring out what you're good at and be very good at it so that it pays for outsiders to work with you. In other words, be a beacon. When it comes to failure, we all know that we need to fail fast. This is probably the most common mantra in the innovation world. You can't visit Silicon Valley without hearing that, you know, if you haven't failed two or three times, the VC won't give you money, right? So what does this mean? Well, here's the dirty little secret. Every CEO says they've embraced fast failure. It's bloody hard to do. Why? We're all type A people. We love to succeed. Now, all of you that have put every failure at the top of your resume, hands up. I don't see a lot of hands, except the gentleman in the front who will be sacked tomorrow, I'm sure, by his company. No, but you're courageous to do so, sir. But here's why we don't do it. It goes against our human nature, right? And it's very difficult. What that means is we need to think about culture in organizations very differently. I spent some time with Jeff Immelt for this book on innovation, and he was kind enough to take me through how he's introducing fast failure to all of his managers. He said, every one of them, I say, it's okay. He used a baseball analogy. He said, you know what? I don't mind if you fail as long as you learn the right lessons. I don't mind if you strike out more often because it gives you the chance to hit more home runs and maybe even get that occasional grand slam. I thought, this is great. What an inspirational leader. What a great company. And to check it out, I went up to the corporate R&D lab in upstate New York. I asked the head of research, so fast failure, how's it working? He said, oh, it's the bane of my existence. I said, what do you mean? It sounds great. He said, look, I kill a project. And 6 months later, I come and find out these guys are still working on the project. They'll come in at nights, on the weekends, they'll work off the budget. Like a dog with a bone, he said, people don't like to give up on their projects. And of course, the insight there is we like to succeed. Culturally, we have to find a different way of finding rewards to encourage fast failure. We could learn something from the company W.L. Gore, the people that make Gore-Tex fabrics. When they kill a project, they throw a party. Now finally, perhaps the most important myth I want to debunk has to do with greed. It's very fashionable to denounce capitalism these days. And when people think about innovation, particularly with these wicked global problems that I've talked about, it's become fashionable to say that government is the solution, capitalism is the problem. Well, I'm going to stick my neck out on a limb. I'm going to say, in fact, I think the pendulum has gone too far. In Western Europe and in America, we've seen the rise of industrial policy. We've seen government get into the business of picking technology winners, once again, as it was in the 70s, of setting up funds, of deciding what industries are, quote unquote, strategic. I think this is a dangerous way to go. I'm a big defender of the role of government, but in a carefully circumscribed way, and funding our research and development and education, in setting up rule of law, capital markets, bankruptcy codes. There's much more that should be done. But in picking winners, I think fundamentally the wrong way to go. And if you look at developing countries where state capitalism is on the rise, a subject of our cover story in The Economist this week, fundamentally the wrong way to go. So what do I mean by capitalism? A different kind of capitalism where we go from greed is good to greed for good, where we reward innovators for solving socially useful problems. And I think that's where capitalism has its due. Rather than moonshots to try to get clean energy, let's reward social innovators, new hybrid business models, philanthrocapitalism. I think really we need to harness incentives and reward the bottom-up innovation that has always come to the rescue. We need to rejig our rules of society and capitalism to reward innovation. So just in conclusion, I really do believe we can tame the grand wicked problems of our age, but with a more robust, more ambitious, more democratic model of innovation that at last taps that one human resource, one natural resource we have in infinite quantity, and that's human ingenuity. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Well, thanks, Wassef. It's a pleasure.
Very happy that you're here.